What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another video of the Off the Ball Network. I'm your host, Nicely Chunga Benny, and I'm here with my co-host, Greg King, from the Ball Fake Podcast. And today, we're going to be talking about two of the most disappointing teams in the entire NBA, in our opinions, thus far this season. But before we hop into all that, make sure you guys like, comment, and subscribe to the Off the Ball Network. Make sure you also do the same for our podcast, the Ball Fake Podcast. We're available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and YouTube as well. So make sure you guys do all that and support us before we hop into this episode and everything. But obviously, like I mentioned earlier, we're going to talk about two of the more disappointing teams in the entire NBA. And I want to start off with the Boston Celtics. Now, Boston, they're a team that has, you know, a lot of talent. And I feel like this is a team that I was very optimistic about, a little bit more optimistic about than most people, given the fact that, you know, I felt like the addition of bringing back Al Horford was going to be a positive. I thought Dennis Schroeder, getting him for under $6 million a year on one year on his contract, I thought he was also going to be somebody that was going to be able to provide a lot to the table offensively, given the fact that this is a guy that just two seasons ago, he was, you know, the runner-up for sixth man of the year and everything. And I thought Josh Richardson, somebody who, you know, has the ability to space the floor out, even though he's struggled to a certain degree this season, and he's going to be able to provide a lot of defense on that side of the basketball, which is an area that Boston definitely needs to improve in. I thought that, you know, tying in all of those factors, Boston was going to be able to get off to a surprisingly good start and be possibly maybe even a top five seed in the Eastern Conference, but that just hasn't been the case. And, yeah, you know, for whatever reason, Jayson Tatum and Jaylen Brown, these two, they have to just do so much for this team offensively. I mean, this is a team that has a lot of talent, like I talked about earlier, but for whatever reason, there's not a lot of cohesion, especially in the locker room. We've seen, you know, Marcus Smart kind of be a little bit unhappy with his role on the team and everything. But I mean, Greg, what do you feel like has been one of the biggest reasons as why Boston struggled so much to start off this season?
I mean, you talked about Jaylen Brown and Jayson Tatum having to do so much, and the reason is their backcourt. I mean, their backcourt is really, they really can't stretch the floor, so they're getting a lot of, they have to take a lot of contested shots, and they're, and a lot of teams are packing the paint on them, and they want to get the ball out of Jayson Tatum and Jaylen Brown's hands. I mean, even though Jayson Tatum at one point, his usage rate was 32%, and he was shooting 26 attempts per game, but he wasn't really sharing the ball. He was only averaging 3.5 assists. So I would like to see those Jaylen Brown and Jayson Tatum to really share the ball more, just like Marcus Smart said. But talking about Marcus Smart and Dennis Schroeder, they got off the slow starts. Dennis Schroeder's coming along, but I really want to focus on Marcus Smart because he's really not giving anything on the offensive end. 9.5 points, 26% from the three-point line, 35% from the field, not really giving them too much. I mean, he's really supposed to be their defensive anchor, and it's really, he's really not setting the tone for this team. And I feel like if he provided more on that offensive end, they could get more better looks, and it's just not really panning out. And then on top of that, you mentioned the bench. You were optimistic about the bench. I mean, I'm not seeing a lot of production out of Josh Richardson right now, and I kind of feel bad for the coach because he's trying to implement his system and he doesn't know where to go to. I mean, you mentioned the defense. Who is he going to put in there to really help with the defensive woes? I like what I'm seeing out of Langford, and his shot, he's improving on the shot, so I feel like he can get more touches off the bench. But they just haven't really figured out their lineup. Are they going to play small ball, or are they going to fit, because they don't have a lot of depth at the front court, and that's another issue that we can get into as well. So I just feel like the lineup issues, Jayson Tatum and Jaylen Brown not getting enough help in their backcourt, is really why they're struggling right now.
And maybe the fact that this is a team that has a lot of redundant and a lot of repetitive talent, maybe that's why it's been so tough for Udoka to really implement the correct lineups and everything. Because when you look at the starting lineup as of late, you know, obviously Jayson Tatum and Jaylen Brown typically are going to be in the starting lineup. Obviously Jaylen Brown's been out due to injury with his hamstring and everything, but he'll be back pretty soon. But when I look at those two guys, they kind of bring the similar values offensively to the table. Both prolific scorers for the most part, all NBA caliber players. Neither one of them great as facilitators, don't do a great job of, you know, getting others involved. And, you know, Marcus Smart obviously is voiced that, and for the most part, both of them are pretty solid defenders. And then when I look at the rest of the starting lineup, as of late, it's been Dennis Schroeder and Marcus Smart. Both of those guys, neither one of them really traditional starting point guards in this league. They're more so better coming off of the bench. Marcus Smart, more of a defender. Dennis Schroeder, a little bit more of a combination guard that, you know, kind of struggles to shoot the basketball. And that's also been a big root of their problems, given the fact that, you know, that backcourt just is not putting a lot of pressure on a lot of these NBA level defenses offensively, because they're not doing a great job of, you know, spacing the floor out and, you know, just being threats offensively. So that's definitely been a huge problem for them. And then I think one issue that I have with Udoka is the lack of minutes for guys like Peyton Pritchard and Aaron Nesmith. Now, I understand that, you know, Boston, they're trying to hang their hat on the defensive end, but when you're a program that typically, you know, is very well known for playing small ball lineups and everything, small ball lineups typically aren't defensive minded lineups. So in that sense, it doesn't really make sense what he's doing, if you ask me, in my opinion. I would like to see a little bit more of an uptick in minutes for guys like Peyton Pritchard and Aaron Nesmith. But, you know, Richardson and Romeo Langford have definitely done a pretty decent job for the most part in playing in their roles and everything. But what are some other issues that you kind of have seen with Boston that you feel like kind of need to be addressed?
I think another alarming issue outside, you know, the percentage is 23. They're 23rd in the league with field goal percentage and 26 in three-point percentage. I think, like I mentioned, I talk about the front court. We talk about it all the time. I think Robert Williams is really good. I think he's a good rim protector. I think he provides so much versatility on the defensive end. But they just, he's not that big that I feel like that the Celtics are looking for. I feel like they really miss Daniel Tice and how he could stretch the floor. I think they need... I mean, it's not really their fault, the player's fault. It's really the front office. But getting the right big for Jayson Tatum and Jaylen Brown, that's another reason why I feel like they're struggling right now. They really haven't been able to find, you know, the perfect front court for those guys.
Yeah, and I think defensively that is plays a part in why they've been so bad. I mean, this is a team that gives up a lot of offensive rebounds, and they're not grabbing enough defensive rebounds. I mean, very reluctant on Horford and Robert Williams from that perspective. Enes Kanter is not one of those guys that's really a high-level rebounder in this league for the most part. And I just don't feel like any of these guys at the center position are really going to provide some of those things that, you know, Boston needs at a high enough level for them to be able to have a postseason run that's going to be really successful like they've had in years past. But going back to, you know, this team not having a lot of floor spacers, once again, I feel like that is another reason as to why, you know, guys like Aaron Nesmith and Peyton Pritchard need an uptick in their minutes. That is something that those guys are able to provide. Now, they haven't shot the basketball all that well this year. And I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that what we talked about earlier, Boston, they don't really have a traditional point guard on this roster. Dennis Schroeder is probably the best bet from that aspect. Like I mentioned, Marcus Smart, more of a defender, not really much of an offensive caliber player. So with all that being said, I think that's one of the biggest reasons as to why, you know, their efficiency levels have, you know, struggled, and it's been so difficult for Tatum and Brown to really be productive offensively because of the lack of spacing, the lack of, you know, reliable options offensively, and the personnel of this team, and them not really being able to figure out the lineups that, you know, have kind of best suited them. But let's move on to the Atlanta Hawks, because that is the second team that we feel like has been, you know, very disappointing this season. They've obviously coming off a Eastern Conference Finals appearance. They obviously ended up losing, and I feel like Atlanta is one of those teams that, you know, is pretty good for the most part, but I do feel like, you know, last year's postseason run, they overachieved to a certain degree. When I look at the Atlanta Hawks and that roster, that is a roster that, you know, definitely has a lot of talent, especially offensively, from guys like Trae Young to Cam Reddish to even Lou Williams on the bench. But I feel like this is a team that does not have a reliable second option. And what I mean by that is John Collins, he can be a little bit inconsistent. We've seen it in the postseason. Defensively, he's pretty good for the most part, but offensively, I just don't feel like he's necessarily the guy that's going to be able to help Trae Young get this Atlanta Hawks team over the top. He's good for 17 points a night, one of the two players in the NBA that can give you 60 plus threes and 60 plus dunks in a season outside of Anthony Davis. But outside of that, he's not much of a shot creator individually, even though we've seen some small improvements from that perspective. And he's not really one of those guys that is honestly gonna put all that much pressure on the defense outside of guys like Trae Young and maybe Cam Reddish. But I just feel like this team needs a better second option, and maybe it can be somebody that, you know, they acquire in maybe a trade in the offseason or at the trade deadline or something of that nature. But I just don't feel like John Collins is that guy, and I think that plays a part in as to why offensively the Atlanta Hawks might not be able to, you know, repeat some of that success that they had last postseason.
Yeah, I get where you're coming from. Actually, I feel like they need a second option on the perimeter. I feel like they have it, but I feel like you can always boost your roster, especially where, you know, the people in the Eastern Conference are getting better, like the Heat and the Bulls and all these other teams who have great second options. So, I mean, Bogdanovich is really good. I feel like he can get more shots off and get more attempts off. He was shooting really high percentages in the playoffs and really came through the clutch for them. But I definitely agree with you there. But I think one thing we have to talk about is they're 28th in defensive rating right now. And I think the versatility in the lineup that they have, and Nate McMillan has at his arsenal, is kind of alarming to me on why they're 28th. Because in the playoffs, they rank 7th in the playoffs in defense. So, but I think one reason right now is like DeAndre Hunter has been injured and Onyeka Okongwu. I feel like his versatility, his ability to switch on screens, and the guards out there, and also playing the paint is a reason why they've been lacking in that area. And I would like to see their defense be better. I mean, Nate McMillan's kind of struggling to trying to figure out guys he can put out there to help him on defensive end. I've been seeing DeLone Wright out there. I've been seeing Solomon Hill out there. Cam Reddish is getting a lot more minutes this year. So he's just trying to balance out the minutes and figure out who's going to help them on that side of the ball, because it's a big, big reason why they've been losing a lot of these games.
Yeah, and I mean, defensively, I think this is a team that relies a little bit too much on their bigs to, you know, kind of save them from their defensive lapses and everything. Like, when I'm looking at guys like Clint Capella and John Collins, what they're able to do on that side of the basketball, I love it. I mean, the rip protection, the athleticism, the presence that they have as shot blockers, I love everything about it. But even with all that stuff being said, this is a team that still gives up nearly 50 points per game in the paint, and that just can't be acceptable. This is an interior defense that is lacking to a certain degree. I think that they also need to do a better job of getting back in transition defense. They're giving up around 13 points per game from that aspect. That can't happen. And then most importantly, they have to do a better job of not committing so many fouls. They're 6th in the NBA in total fouls committed. Boston was actually number 1. And, you know, with all that being said, those type of things definitely need to be addressed for whatever reason. I don't know if guys aren't doing a great job of communicating, or they're just understanding the fact that, you know, they have reliable shot blockers that are going to be able to, you know, get them out of a lot of those defensive laps that they're committing. But for whatever reason, Atlanta definitely needs to clean up on that side of the basketball, especially from a rebounding perspective, because offensively, they're not doing a good job of, you know, capitalizing on and closing out their defensive possessions. They're not a great rebounding team. They are only averaging around like 35 rebounds per game, which is very putrid. And then they're giving up nearly 9 offensive rebounds per game as well. So when we see them start to clean those aspects up in their game, I think that's when we're going to start to see a little bit more cohesion on that side of the basketball. And hopefully Atlanta can start, you know, racking up a few more wins from that perspective and be able to possibly get back to where they were able to get to last postseason.
Yeah, I totally agree, because they're 5th in offensive rating nicely. So in the versatility that they have on offense, I mean, the pick and roll with John Collins, they can dish it off to Bogdanovich. They have DeAndre Hunter. They have Cam Reddish. They have so many guys you can put the ball in the basket. If they can clean up and, you know, clean up on the defensive end, communicate on the defensive end, and get that right personnel, bring him, get Kongu back healthy, get Hunter back healthy, I think they can get back into what they were in the playoffs when they had a stellar defense throughout that run.
Yeah, and then lastly, talking about their offense, with this team being so great as three-point shooters, you would expect them, you know, actually shoot a lot more attempts than they do. So it kind of alarms me that they're kind of towards the back end of the NBA in three-point attempts, because they have so many guys that are able to, you know, knock down shots from outside at an extremely efficient rate. I mean, they have nearly, what, 4 or 5 guys that are shooting well above league average. So that kind of surprises me to a certain degree that they're not capitalizing on that.
Well, they're fifth in two-point attempts, so that's alarming. I mean, I know Nate McMillan, when he was winning the Pacers, he liked to get inside. So I kind of see where you're coming from there. Only 27th in three-point attempts. So I would like to see Bogdanovich get more touches on the three-point line, because they can really put the ball in the basket out there. So that's very alarming.
And if that's the case, then they have to do a better job of getting to the free throw line, because even from that perspective, they're still towards the bottom half of the entire NBA. So when we start to factor some of those things in offensively, it's not really making too much sense if I'm looking at it from that perspective. But ultimately, I do think this is a unit that, you know, has a lot to offer from an offensive perspective. They have a lot of guys that can get their own shot individually, and sometimes that might be a detriment to them, because I feel like they don't always do a great job of utilizing their teammates outside of guys like Trae Young. But ultimately, I think for the most part, this is what Atlanta does for the most part. They don't do a great job of starting off the season. They typically turn things around towards the second half after the All-Star break and everything. So hopefully we can kind of see a resurgence from them on both sides of the basketball. But ultimately, I feel like Atlanta should be fine for the most part. I just think that, you know, them coming off of Eastern Conference Finals last year, they kind of, you know, have a little bit of Conference Finals hangover for whatever reason. But hey, you guys let us know what y'all think about this entire situation in the comment section. Do you feel like Boston and Atlanta can turn things around, or do you feel like both of these franchises are going to be in a rut for the remainder of the year? But thank you guys so much for tuning in to another video with the Off the Ball Network and the Ball Fake Podcast. Make sure you catch me and Greg's podcast on YouTube and Apple Podcasts and Spotify as well, and do the same thing for the Off the Ball Network as well. And make sure you guys like, comment, and subscribe, and follow us on all social media platforms. But besides that, it's your boy Nicey Chunga Benny. I'm here with my co-host Greg King. And we out.
We out.